Hello guys, welcome to Bhavna's Online Academy. So in this video we are going to see the chapter of liquidation. In that, this is the first part in which we are going to learn about statement of affairs. So in this video you will be learning the concept of it, and also if possible I'll try to include a sum also. And if you want to see other chapters and other parts of this, the link of the playlist will be in the description box below. So let's get into the video, guys.
Liquidation of companies means nothing but the company being wound up. The company being closed or wound up is known as liquidation of companies. A very simple chapter if understood properly. Okay. So this is what is liquidation of company. A company being closed or being wound up. Okay. So when we are going to read this liquidation of companies chapter, that are nearly four concepts that we are going to read. Okay, there are nearly four concepts. One is going to be statement of affairs. The other one is going to be liquidator's final statement. And then you have receiver's final statement or receiver's statement. And then you have, finally, there's one more concept known as B-list contributories. So B-list contributes. So all of these are there in your portion. So we are going to read this one by one, a day at a time. Okay. So today we are going to start with the statement of affairs. Okay. So now statement of affairs. So what is statement of affairs? So statement of affairs is a statement. Okay. Statement of affairs is a statement which is prepared by the officials of the company, which is prepared by the officials of a company. So the company which is going to be wound up, in that there will be board of directors, there will be few higher officials, CEO or CFO or any higher officials of the company. They will prepare this statement. They will prepare this statement of affairs. So what will be in this statement of affairs? So statement of affairs, always remember, is prepared before liquidation of companies. It is prepared before liquidation of company. Okay, fine. So I'll tell you when this is actually prepared. So you know what will happen is this liquidation of companies, you know, this liquidation of company may either happen at somebody's request. Okay. Or it might happen due to the request of company. The company will go and request to the tribunal that they want to wind up. The company will go and request to the tribunal that they want to wind up. In such case also, they'll prepare the statement of affairs. Or in case somebody else, or in case somebody else, that is a third party, if they have told that the company should wind up and the company is not interested in winding up, okay, they are against it. In such case also, they will prepare the statement of affairs and submit it to the tribunal. Okay. So at the end of the day, it is a statement which is prepared by the... One second, guys. Please mute yourself, guys, when you enter in, okay? Okay. So at the end of the day, statement of affairs is a statement which is prepared by the higher officials of a company, and it is submitted to the tribunal. But this all happens before liquidation of companies. All of this is going to happen before liquidation of company. Okay, so I hope the basic of what statement of affairs is clear to you. So now what and all is there in statement of affairs is what we are going to understand. Okay, here I'll tell you. Wait. Okay. Once again. Okay. So now what and all is there in this statement? In this statement of affairs, what and all is there? So what the company officials will do is that they will prepare a list. In this list, they will have a list of assets and liabilities, assets at their realizable value, and liabilities at their estimated settlement value they will put. Okay. So all of this, what you need to remember is estimated is what you have to remember. The assets realizable value or the liabilities settlement value, all of this is going to be estimated only. Because see, on the day of liquidation only, you can correctly say, like, not in estimation, in proper terms, you can only say it on day of liquidation. This statement, since we are preparing before liquidation, in this statement, all the figures, all the values are going to be in an estimated form. So this is a statement of nothing, but this is the statement where you're going to say what is the assets realizable value and what are the liabilities payable or settlement value. So I'll again repeat. So what is statement of affairs? Statement of affairs is a statement where you are going to state all the estimated values of assets realizable and liabilities payable or liabilities to be settled. Okay. So I hope all the basics of a statement of affairs is clear to you. So now we are going to move into the concept of statement of affairs. So part one, what you are going to read is the statement of affairs. Wait, okay. So in the to understand the statement of affairs or to understand the statement or the format of the statement, you would need to understand a few lists. You would need to understand a few lists. Okay. So now we will start by understanding the list. Okay, fine. So far you here totally you have around 8 lists. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yes. You have totally 8 lists. Okay. It starts from A and ends at H. It starts from A and ends at H. Okay. So now I'll start by explaining you each and every list. Okay. So first this list A. Okay. So what is list A? In list, so remember your list. Wait. So remember your list A and your list B. These both lists is going to consist of all the assets or is related to all the assets. And then your list C, D and E. The next three lists is going to be related to liabilities. Okay. And the final list F and list D is related to the shareholders of the company. So remember your list A and list B is related to assets of the company. List C, list D and list C is related to liabilities of the company. List F and list G is related to the shareholders of the company. And finally, you have list H. Okay. So now first start by, now let's, once again. Okay. So now let's start by understanding the list which are related to assets of the company. Okay. That is list A and list B we are going to understand now. So what is list A? So list A is assets not specifically pledged and list B is assets specifically pledged. So what is the meaning of specifically pledged here? Specifically pledged means suppose there is a liability or suppose there is an asset. Okay. In your company, you have an assets of plant and machinery. Okay. Suppose you have taken a loan from a bank. Suppose you have taken a bank loan. So whenever you take a bank loan, what the bank authorities will ask you is to submit a security with them. Submit a security with them. Why the bank, why the bank people will tell you to submit a security with them is because suppose in case of default of loan, suppose in case you don't pay the loan, they will try to recover the loan amount from your security. They will try to recover the loan amount from your security. Okay. So in such case, the security can be any asset of the company. Suppose they have pledged. Suppose they have given the plant and machinery of their company as security against bank loan, then this asset of plant and machinery, then this asset of plant and machinery will be known as asset which is specifically pledged. That means it is pledged against some liability or some kind of a loan of a company. So asset which is given as a security. So an asset which is given as a security against some kind of a liability or a loan. Okay. So such kind of asset will be known as an asset which is specifically pledged. So that will be known as an asset which is specifically pledged. Okay. So this will come under list B. So under list B, you will have assets specifically pledged. In list A, all the assets other than the assets of list B, all other assets other than the assets of list B, that means assets which is not specifically pledged will come under list A. So all the assets other than list B assets, or you can say all the assets which is not specifically pledged will come under list A. So this was about list A and list B. I hope this is clear. Okay. Another thing that you will have to understand is that in list A, there is one more item that is going to come, which will be called as calls in arrears. which will be known as calls in arrears. Okay, so all the arrears. So what calls in arrears? What is the meaning of calls in arrears? That means what will happen is, so you would have read in your 12th standard, 11th standard or foundation that suppose if the face value of a share of a company is 10 rupees and suppose they are issuing the share at a premium, or we'll just keep it as normally face value only. Okay. Suppose they have issued, okay, the company has issued the share at 10 rupees value. In application, they might collect 2 rupees. Then in this allotment, they might collect 3 rupees. Then in first call, they might collect 4 rupees. Then in last call, final call, they might collect 1 rupee. So like this, one by one, they will call the amount, right? So suppose they have called this amount, okay, this 4 rupees, suppose they have called up as their first call. And suppose a few shareholders, suppose a few shareholders have not paid this call of 4 rupees, then in such case, those calls will be known as calls in arrears. So such calls will be known as calls in arrears, okay? So the call amount, so the amount which have been called up, so the amount which has been called up but not paid will come under calls in arrears. Okay, fine. So this is one thing that you have to remember. This calls in arrears, what you have to think is that, see, assets and all, for assets you will have realizable value. So that estimated realizable value you can take in list A. But in case of calls in arrears, what you will do is that you will assume that this calls in arrears have been realized in full, and that value you will put under list A. So you will assume that the calls in arrears, suppose that calls in arrears was 4 rupees into, for 10,000 shares you have not received the money yet. So 40,000 rupees you will put in calls in arrears under list A. So you have to assume that the value what you have not realized have actually been realized in full. So if you assume so, and whatever value comes, so here see, this 4 rupees, once again. So here, see, this 4 rupees, what you have, this is actually not been realized. But since this is an estimated statement that on the day of liquidation, you realize all of these things. So you have to assume that has been realized and you have to put it here as calls in arrears. Okay. And one more point that you have to remember. One more point that you have to remember against calls in arrears is that uncalled capital you should not take. Uncalled capital you should not take into account in list A. Under list A, uncalled capital will not come. What is uncalled capital here? See, this 1 rupee which is there, which has to be yet to be called as final call, you have not called up yet. So how will the other people also pay? So whatever uncalled capital is there, that will not come under list A. Only calls in arrears is going to come under list A. So this was one thing that you had to remember regards to list A. I hope the list A and list B is clear to you now. Any doubts in list A and list B, guys? Can I move on to the other list now? You guys can answer if you have any doubt. I will clear it right away. Okay, fine. So the next part we are going to read is about list C. So as I told you, list C, D, E. So list C, D, E, all of these are related to the liabilities of the company. So all of these are related to the liabilities of the company. So the first one is list C. So what and all will come under list C is creditors which are preferential. So always remember in this chapter when you use the word creditors, the creditors not only means creditors, but it includes all the liabilities. In this chapter, all the liabilities are known as creditors only. So when the term called as creditors is given, don't confuse yourself. All kind of liabilities will come under these creditors. Okay. So here in list C also you have creditors, list D also you have creditors, list E also you have creditors only. Okay. But the terms which are used here in case of creditors is different. In list C you have preferential creditors, in list D you have floating charge creditors. In list C, list E, you have unsecured creditors. Okay, so then what is the difference between these three creditors? What is preferential creditors? What is floating charge? And what is unsecured creditors? We have to see now. Okay, fine. So first we are going to start with preferential creditors. So what and all will come under preferential creditors? Here, see, this All of these six items is going to come under preferential creditors. All of the six items is going to come under preferential creditors. That means what you have to do is, if suppose in the question, they will give you a lot of liabilities. They will not tell you what kind of creditors it is, whether it is list C, list D or list E. You only have to find out what kind of creditors it is and have to put under the specified list. So how will you find out what is preferential creditors? So here they have given you a list of preferential creditors. So they itself have specified. See, all of these six items will come under your preferential creditor. Okay, so what is preferential creditor? Preferential creditor is list C. Okay, fine. So first, what will come is all dues to the government. So whatever dues you have, that you have to pay to the government, that is whatever the company has to pay to the government, let it be state government or central government. Okay, so whatever dues you have to pay to the government, that is going to come in preferential creditors. That is going to come under preferential creditors. Okay, then next is whatever wages, salary or commission that you have to pay to the employees. So whatever wages, salary or commission that you have to pay to the employees within 12 months from the date of liquidation. Okay, that means suppose the date of liquidation is 31st March 21, within 12 months. That means from 1st April 20 till 31st March 21, within this time period, if you have any wages, salary or commission due to employees, that will come under preferential creditor. But here comes the most important point, which is usually tested in the examination. This point is one of the most important points. Okay, this is a point which is usually tested in the exam. So what they tell you is, see, all the creditors or all the wages, salary and commission comes under 12 months from the date of liquidation is not preferential creditors. Here there is one point that you have to remember. Let's see, 4 months salary or 20,000, which is less, will only come under preferential creditor. I'll again repeat, 4 months salary or 20,000, whichever is less, will only come under preferential creditors. The remaining amount which is there will go to unsecured creditors. Okay. To explain this, I'll take a point. Okay. So what they tell you in the question is that, see, there is a salary of employee which is due. Okay. And this due is for 6 months. And this due is for 6 months. And the total amount of due is 50,000, and the total amount of due is 50,000. So what they tell you in the question is, see, there is salary. The salary is due, and the salary due is within 12 months of the date of liquidation. That means it is salary due is of last 6 months only, but the amount of salary due is 50,000 rupees. So in this 50,000 rupees, now you have to find out how much will relate to preferential creditors and how much will go into unsecured creditors. Okay, so here they have told you a point that 4 months salary or 20,000, whichever is less. So first you have to find out 4 months salary. So here they have told you 6 months salary is 50,000 rupees. You have to find out 4 months salary here. Okay, so what will be 4 months salary? Can someone calculate and tell me? So it will be 50,000 divided by 6, you will get 1 month salary. And if you do into 4, you will get 4 month salary. So the 4 month salary, someone has told me, it is 33,333. So it is 33,333. Very good, guys. So this is the 4 month salary. Okay. So what they told you was, you have to see whatever the 4 month salary is, that is 33,333. Or 20,000, whichever is less, that you have to take it as preferential creditors. So in such case, what you will do? Only the 20,000 rupees you are going to take it as your preferential creditors. The 20,000 rupees only you will take it as preferential creditors. Okay. So can someone tell me how much will go into unsecured creditors? How much will go into unsecured creditors? So it will be nothing but 50,000 minus 20,000, which has already been classified as preferential creditors. Very good. 30,000 will go into unsecured creditors. 30,000 will go into unsecured creditors. Here I'll give you another case. Suppose the 4 month salary. Okay, after calculating, suppose the 4 month salary was 18,000. Okay, then in such case, how much will it go to preferential? And how much, suppose the total salary of 6 months. Okay, suppose the total salary, I'll just give. Okay, so 6 months, how much will be the salary? 18,000 divided by 4 into 6. One second. What is the total salary? Just tell me the 6 month salary. Wait, I'll go get my calculator. Okay, guys. Yeah. So the 6 month salary is 27,000 rupees. So here I found out that the 4 month salary is 18,000. Then you have to tell me how much will be preferential and how much will be unsecured. Okay, now you can tell me. So I see a few answers already there. So all the first what you have to see is 4 month salary you have to find out, which is 18,000 or 20,000, whichever is less. Or 20,000, which was less. So in such case, 18,000 will go to your preferential creditors. And the remaining amount, what is the remaining amount? 27,000 minus 18,000, which is 9,000, will go into your unsecured creditors. Okay. So I hope this important point of 4 month salary or 20,000, whichever is less in relation to preferential creditors, is clear to you. Okay, so once again, this concept we'll see while we are solving the sums also. So you'll get more clarity there. Okay, next you have expenses of investigation. This will also come under, if in the question they have given you expenses of investigation, that also you have to write under preferential creditors. Then you have all holiday remuneration to employees. So this will also come under preferential payments. Then you have contribution under ESI. So what is this ESI? ESI means employee state insurance. Yes. So ESI. So whatever contribution you have under ESI will come under contribution, or whatever the amount is payable by the company under the employee state insurance, it will come under your preferential creditors. So this also, it should be due within last 12 months. This contribution under ESI or amount payable by the company under ESI will come under, which is due within the last 12 months, will come under preferential creditors. Then finally, you have any PF or pension fund, or then you have a gratuity fund, which is payable to the employees, that will come under preferential creditors. So what and all will come under preferential creditors? All the dues to government, wages, salary or commission which the company has to give to the employees due within the last 12 months, expenses of investigation, holiday remuneration which the company has to pay to the employee, contribution under employee state insurance which is due within the last 12 months, and finally provident fund, pension fund or gratuity fund, or any those kinds of funds which are, or any amount which is payable to employee under the Employee Workmen Compensation Act, or any amount which is payable to employee under Workmen Compensation Act will also come under this. Okay, so here you have to remember that. See, once again. So here you have to remember that. See, point number 2, point number 4, 5, 6. All of these are related to employees only. Point number 2, 4, 5, 6. All of these are related to employee only. First point is related to the government and the third point is related to investigation. So this you have to remember. Okay. So I hope what is preferential creditors is also clear to you. These are all directly in the question they'll give you. Okay. So you just have to pick and put it under preferential creditors. Okay. So here I told you that, see, wages, salary or commission due to employees will come under preferential creditors, right? So in the question, sometimes you might get confused what is preferential and what will go to unsecured. So always remember, whatever creditors, okay, I'll not tell you here. So just remember that point, I'll tell you in the last. So if suppose in the question they have given you manager's salary, suppose they have given you manager's salary, it will come under preferential creditors. Suppose they have given you secretary's salary, that will come under preferential creditors. Okay. So usually whatever doesn't go into preferential creditors will usually go to unsecured creditors only. So if in the question they have given you director's salary or managing director's salary, all those will go into unsecured creditors. So remember, manager, secretary salary, because they are like an employee to the company. Directors are not employed to the company. Are board of directors employed to the company? No, right? So this manager, secretary and all will only go under preferential creditors, whereas unsecured creditors, suppose director salary or managing director salary is there, it will go under unsecured creditors. I hope preferential creditors is all clear to you. So now we have completed with our list C also. Okay, we have completed with our list C. The next thing that we are going to go understand is the creditors of floating charge. So what are creditors of floating charge is that, here I told you that asset has a specific charge. Like, see, this plant and machinery is only given as a security against this bank loan. Suppose if there is a, liability, suppose you can take the liability of debentures. If this liability of debentures has a charge on all the assets, suppose there is a liability which has a charge on all the assets, then such will be known as floating charge creditors. Such will be known as floating charge creditors. Okay. It has a charge on all the assets. Example is debenture. In most of your question, debentures will only come under floating charge. If not, then you can also expect sometimes in the question, they will also tell you of bank OD also. So that also has a floating charge on all the assets. Usually in our ICI, debentures, they will give us floating charge. So that debentures you can write under list D, floating charge. Okay. So here then finally you have creditors which are unsecured. Here you have creditors which are unsecured. That means, see, totally there are creditors of four types. Creditors of four types. Secured creditors, preferential creditors, creditors of floating charge, then finally you have you can say unsecured creditors, or you can say non-preferential creditors. Okay, so there are totally four types of creditors. This, see, I already told you that preferential creditor will come under list C, floating charge will come under list D, and unsecured or non-preferential will come under list E. So where, so what is this secured creditors then, and under what list will it come is what we are going to understand now. So see, secured creditors means a creditor or a liability which is secured against some asset. Suppose if there is this bank loan, is secured against this plant and machinery. So in such case, what will be the bank loan called as? The bank loan will be called as an secured creditor. This bank loan will be called as your secured creditor. So what is secured creditor? Secured creditors means the creditors against which there is a asset which is pledged. So secured creditors, this will come under, see, this will come under list B itself. This will go under list B itself. I'll tell you how you will write this, okay? Then preferential creditor, I told you six things that will come under preferential creditors. Then floating charge, I told you also liabilities which are charged over all assets will come under floating charge list D. What is in list E? List E means all other liabilities or all other creditors which does not come under the above three lists. All the liabilities or creditors which doesn't come under the above three lists will come under list E and will be known as secured creditors or non-preferential creditors. Here, one more thing that you have to remember is that sometimes preferential creditors, like I told you, right? Here, see, this preferential creditors, this unsecured part here, I've told you 30,000. So a part which is not a preferential creditors, if there is a creditor, and if some of it is preferential creditor, then the remaining part of which is not a preferential creditor will come under secured or non-preferential. again I'll repeat, if there is a creditor and if some part of it is preferential, the remaining part of it is going to be non-preferential. So such non-preferential of the remaining part will come under secured or non-preferential creditor, which is list E. Okay, so I've explained you about list C, list D, and list E also. List C, list D, and list E also. So until this, is everybody clear? Yes. Fine. So then list F, list G, list H is very easy only. So in list F, what you will have is that. So in list F, whatever amount is payable to preference shareholders will come under list F. And in list G, whatever amount is payable to equity shareholders will come under list G. And then finally, you have a list known as list H, in which you will get this surplus or deficiency. From where will we get this surplus or deficiency is that, see, so in the start itself, when I was explaining you the concept of this statement of affairs, I told you whatever you write in the statement of affairs is only an estimated value. Correct. Let it be assets realized or liabilities settled. All of this is an estimated value only is what I told. Okay. So now, see, you will have a lot of assets from where you realize some cash. Then from this assets or from the cash what you have in hand, you will pay out the liabilities. You will pay out the liabilities. Then after that, you will have some money left. From this money, you will pay to the shareholders of the company. They may be equity shareholders also, preference shareholders also. So after you pay to them, whatever money which is left, so whatever money which is left will either be extra money you will have in hand, or you will have a negative balance. This balance which is left can either be a negative balance or a positive balance. Suppose if it is a positive balance, it will be considered as surplus. And that means after, even though after paying liabilities and shareholders also, you have some cash left with you. That is, you have surplus, or it may be deficiency, that is shortage of cash. Or there may be shortage of cash. Okay. So surplus of deficiency you will get after solving all these lists. Okay. So I hope all of these 8 lists is clear to you. So again, I'll repeat one last time. List A, list B are related to asset. C, D, and E are related to liabilities. F and G are related to shareholders. List H is related to surplus or deficiency. Okay. So all these lists, now that you have understood this list, statement of affairs is a very easy matter to you all. Okay, now that you have understood all the concepts in detail, when we are going to read the statement of affairs, it is going to be a very, very easy concept. Okay, so shall we start with statement of affairs, guys? So shall we start with the format? After seeing the format, so I'll tell you what is left. So after seeing this format, we are going to see one illustration from our ICA study material, and after that we will wind up the class. All the other sums in the next class we will see. Okay. Okay, guys. So yes. So now we are going to start with statement of affairs. Now we are going to start with statement of affairs format. Statement of affairs format. Okay. So first, what you have to do is, first you have to start by writing list A. First, you have to start by writing list A. All the assets which are not specifically pledged. Okay, so all the assets which are not specifically pledged, all the assets you have to write. Your example, plant and machinery. Then you might have land and building. Then you might have cash in hand or cash in bank. Then you can also have call scenarios like I told you. So all of these things, whatever their estimated realizable value is there, you will write here. Okay, so you will write here. I'll write it here. Okay. So all of these things you will write it, and then you will total, and then you will write the total of it here, and you will do the total of all these and you will write it here. Okay. So what are these assets? All these assets are assets which are not specifically pledged. Okay. So all these are assets which are not specifically pledged, then you will write it here. So we'll name this. Okay. So this total of assets which are not specifically pledged, we will name it as. So here, since we have already named A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I will name this as I. Okay, so the total of this, we will call it as I. Okay, fine. Then what you will have to do is, next you have to start by writing list B. So list which B means assets which are specifically pledged, you have write, you have to write here. So you have to follow this format. First, you have to write an asset. Suppose we'll take the asset, we'll take out plant and machinery from this. Okay, suppose the asset which is specifically pledged is plant and machinery. Okay, and suppose the realizable value of plant and machinery is 5 lakh rupees. You have to write the 5 lakh rupees realizable value here. Then you have to write liabilities outstanding. That means against this asset, what was the liability that you had taken up? It was bank loan, right? Suppose the asset, suppose the liability which is bank loan. Okay. Okay, this liability is bank loan. So what is the bank loan outstanding amount you have to see? For what amount have you taken a bank loan you have to see? Suppose I have taken a bank loan for rupees 4,80,000 and my assets realizable value is 5 lakh, then in such case, how much will be my deficiency or surplus, and whether it will be deficiency or surplus, can someone tell me? I'll write the second case also here. Realizable value is 5 lakh. Liability outstanding is 5,50,000. Okay, so for the first case, it is going to be surplus. Very well answered, because see, plant and machinery, the liability that you have to pay is 4,80,000 only. But when you are going to sell this plant and machinery, you are going to get 5 lakh rupees. So in this 5 lakh rupees, first you can pay 4,80,000 and the remaining 20,000 will go into surplus. And the remaining 20,000 will go into surplus. So what will you do with this 20,000 remaining amount? So what will you do with this 20,000 remaining amount? With this remaining amount of 20,000, you can settle other liabilities. You can settle other liabilities. You can settle other liabilities, because all the liabilities which is secured creditors, you would have already settled using the realizable value of 4,80,000. With the remaining 20,000, you can settle down other liabilities. Can someone tell me the answer for second case? What will be the answer for second case? Your realizable value is 5 lakh, but you have to pay for a liability of 5,50,000. Then in such case, 50,000 will be your deficiency, because see, 5,50,000 is the amount that you have to pay, but the amount which you receive by selling the plant and machinery is only 5 lakh rupees. That means 50,000 you still have to pay. 50,000 rupees you still have to pay to the bank people. Okay, so the bank loan, you still have to pay 50,000. Then this 50,000 will come under deficiency. So this 50,000 will now come under deficiency. So what you have to remember is, this 50,000 rupees which has come under deficiency, where will you pay it? 5 lakh you have already paid under list B. 5 lakh you have already paid under list B. This remaining 50,000, what you have to do is, you have to pay under list E. What was list E? Can someone tell me? List E was your unsecured creditors. List E was your unsecured creditors. So whatever remaining amount of 50,000 deficiency, which you were not able to pay using this 5 lakh rupees of asset value, the remaining value of 50,000 will become unsecured and will be paid under list E. I'll again explain you this one concept alone. See, so this is the bank. Okay, so in the bank, I have taken a loan of 5,50,000 rupees, and against this loan, I have pledged my plant and machinery to the bank. What the bank told me was that in case of default of payment, that means in case the company doesn't make the payment of 5,50,000 of loan, the bank will pay, or the bank will sell this plant and machinery and realize the amount. Okay, suppose what happened, we did not make the payment. Okay, suppose we did not make the payment of 5,50,000, then the next option that is available to bank is to sell whatever asset we have. Okay, asset we have pledged with the bank. Suppose what they do is, they take the plant and machinery and they go to the market. They go to the market and they try to sell this plant and machinery. Okay. They actually want 5,50,000 from this plant and machinery. But what happens is, from the market, they are only able to receive 5 lakh. From the market, they were only able to receive 5 lakh. So in such case, the remaining 50,000, what they have to do, the remaining 50,000 they were not able to realize from plant and machinery. So in such case, the remaining 50,000 they have to get it from the company only. So in company, they will come under unsecured creditors, and in such role or in such position, they will receive the 50,000. So I hope this deficiency is clear. Okay. So whenever a deficiency is going to come, you have to write the 50,000 here, but you have to include it with the list E. Okay. Surplus of 20,000 will come here. Surplus of 20,000 will come outside. Okay. The deficiency amount you will not write the outside. The surplus alone, 20,000, you can write it in the outer column. Okay. Wait, I'll clear this a little bit. Okay. So you don't have any confusion. Okay. So as I told you, list A, value you will get, total value you will get here. Then surplus of 20,000 rupees also you will have to write outside. Okay. And the total amount, whatever is there, that will be the total amount which you can use for paying the liabilities. Suppose you got 1 lakh from other assets by realizing other assets and 20,000 was your surplus. Then in such case, 1,20,000 is the amount which you can use to pay all the other liabilities. Pay all the other liabilities. Other liabilities means liabilities other than secured creditors. I just leave. Pay all other liabilities. Okay. So what we are going to do is we are going to just name it. Okay. I'll name the total. I am going to name the total of list A as I. I'm going to name the surplus of list B. Name the surplus of list B, nothing. Okay, I'll not name it anything. I'll just name the total. I'm going to name the total of list A and list B as J. I, J only, no, after that, yes. Total of list A and list B, I'm going to name it as J. So until this, are these both list clear? Is this format clear, guys? Any doubt in this? Anybody who has any doubts? Okay, fine. Clear, right? Okay. Next, what we are going to see is third, what you have to write is you have to write the summary of gross assets realized. What you have to write next? Next, you have to write summary of gross assets realized. So what is the summary of gross assets realized? Means nothing. So from list A assets, how much amount did you realize? From list B assets, how much amount did you realize? You have to write here. See, from list A, how much did we realize? We realized 1 lakh rupees, right? So from list A asset, how much did we realize? We realized 1 lakh rupees. So 1 lakh, sorry. Yeah. So 1 lakh rupees, you have to write here, correct? Okay. So from list B assets, how much did you realize? So I told you, you had an assets of plant and machinery. And the realizable value first, it was 5 lakh rupees. So how much you have, you should not see whatever is in the loan outstanding column or deficiency column or surplus column. From the list B asset, how much did you realize? By selling plant and machinery, how much did you realize? You realized 5 lakh rupees. So the total of realizable value column will come here. So how much did you realize from list B assets? 5 lakh rupees. So totally 6 lakh rupees is the gross as realized. Gross means before paying to the liabilities, how much was the amount that you had realized? Okay, before paying to the liabilities, how much amount you had realized? So the amount which was realized was 5 lakh and 1 lakh rupees. So totally 6 lakh rupees will be your total summary of gross assets realized. Okay, so what is this 1 lakh? So this 1 lakh, as we saw, was your I, right? So this was your I, see? This I has only come here. So this is I here, you have J. And then the 6 lakh, we can also name it as K. This 6 lakh total of gross assets realized, I'll name it as K. Okay. Then you have 4. Then fourth one is going to be your gross liabilities. Then the fourth one is going to be a gross liability. So now we have already completed list A and list B. So after list A and list B, as I told you, there will be 3 more lists, which is list C, list D and list E. All these are related to liabilities. So all these lists in one itself, we are going to put. So you're going to give a head known as gross liabilities. And under this head itself, you are going to see list C, list D, and list E also. Okay, fine. So now you have to make this format. In this format, you will write gross value, particulars, and estimated value. Gross value means the value, which is gross, which is payable, which is the gross amount payable. Okay, so now when I tell you or when I explain you the sum, you will be able to understand better. For now, just see the format alone. First, you will have balance brought down. So balance brought down means after realizing all the assets and what is the balance that you are going to get? That is what you have to write here. So here you have to write the J. Whatever the J amount is there, you have to write. So how much amount will you write here in balance brought down? Can someone tell me? So here this will be the total of list A and list B surplus. J. So here you are going to write as 120,000. Okay, so balance brought down 120,000 you have to write here. In the gross column, you have to write as zero. In the gross column, you have to write as zero. Then next you have to write credit as secured as list B. So can someone tell me the example which I told you for secured creditors which will come under list B? What was the example that I gave you of secured creditors of list B? See, here I told you when I was explaining what was the one example, nobody is able to answer. What happened? See, didn't I tell you secured creditors are those creditors against which? Debentures. No, not at all. What are secured creditors against which there is some security of asset? Now at least tell me. If you would have understood this properly, you can understand. I also even showed you what is list B asset. I mean list B creditors. I made that there were four creditors. I think I erased it now. Or is it there? So see, I told you what is secured creditors which will come under list B. Why is nobody able to answer? So tell me if you are not able to answer, then I will. If you don't know, say no. Okay, someone has answered it correctly. Others, I'll explain it once again if you don't understand. See, secured creditors list B assets means the asset against which there is, means some liability against which there is a security of asset. Like I told you, bank loan. So bank loan will come under creditors secured or secured creditors list B. Bank loan will come under this, okay? So here bank loan. So whatever the estimated value of bank loan is there, you have to write here. Okay, so estimated value of bank loan you will write here. And here you will write the amount to the extent claim is covered by asset specifically pledged. Okay, suppose your estimated value of bank loan was 5 lakh rupees. But the amount that you were able to pay of this 5 lakh or the amount that you were able to recover from plant and machinery was only 4,80,000, then in such case 4,80,000 you will write here. Okay, 4,80,000 you will write here. So 5 lakh you are going to write as how much amount you have to pay and how much amount you have actually paid using the asset or the secured asset, you have to write it here. That is 4,80,000. So balance brought down, credit as secured, I have told you. Did you understand what is secured creditors? The people who didn't answer bank loan or the people who have answered debentures. Debentures, I told you, is a floating charge. It is not secured creditors. Have you understood? Others, I want everyone to answer. Only if you answer, then I'll proceed. See, if you didn't understand, say at least you didn't understand, then you will not be able to solve the sum at all. Okay. Yes, fine. Okay, guys, fine. So now then you have to write creditors which are preferential, list C. The same amount only here and here it will come. Then you have creditors of floating charge. The same thing will come here and here. Then you have creditors of non-preferential nature. That means in above three lists, if there is any creditors which did not come, that will come under preferential creditor. The same amount here and here it will come. And then finally, there'll be surplus or deficiency to creditors. That means from 1,20,000, how much ever you have paid to, what do you say? How much ever you have paid to the other creditors, you have to reduce it. And then the remaining amount will come here as surplus or deficiency. Okay. So from this surplus or deficiency, you have to give amount to preference shareholders, equity shareholders, and then again another surplus or deficiency to members will come. Okay. So see, first you had to write assets specifically pledged, then assets non-specifically pledged will be your first one. Second one, you have to write assets specifically pledged. Third one, you have to write a summary of gross assets realized. Fourth one, you have to write about gross liabilities, that column you have to prepare, from which you will get surplus or deficiency to creditors. Then you have to just write under that whatever the gross assets realized are there and the gross assets repaid are there, you have to write this. This I'll explain you while I'm explaining the sum. Now if I tell you, you'll get confused. Okay. Then fifth, you have to prepare something known as distribution to members, under which you will write deficiency or surplus to creditors. That means here, from here, whatever value you get, you have to write here. Okay. And then you will write whatever you have payable to preference shareholders, whatever you have payable to equity shareholders. Then the remaining amount will come as list H amount. Suppose the remaining amount you have in hand is 50,000 surplus. Okay, 50,000 surplus. Then finally, you have something known as list H. Finally, something you have known as list H. So what is list H? List H is a surplus or deficiency amount. So in this surplus or deficiency account, what you will do is you will explain how you got this 50,000. You have to explain here how you got this 50,000. So you have to explain how you got this 50,000. So until now, till the 5 points, you found out that what is the surplus or deficiency. In the sixth point, that is the list H surplus or deficiency account, you will say how you got that 50,000 deficiency or surplus. So here you have to write items contributing to deficiency. Then you have to write items contributing to surplus. Okay. So now for now, understand what this is. When we do the sum, you will understand it more clearly. Okay. So here, now I'll ask you whether you want to do the sum and come back to this concept, or understand the concept and go to the sum. Because I don't know at what level of understanding you are. If you feel the other 5 things itself you have not understood, you don't have a proper clarity on it, we'll do the sum and we'll come to list H. So tell me whether you want to do the 5 points first along do as a sum and then come to list H, or you want to first understand the list H and then go to the sum. Sum first. Okay, everybody has said sum first, so we'll do the sum. Okay, so now just remember all of these. Okay, so just remember all of these concepts, whatever I told you. Okay, it will start as Insol Limited. Okay, okay, yes, now it is clear. Okay, so illustration number 11. So they have told that Insol Limited is to be liquidated. So Insol Limited is the company's name. Okay. The following balance are extracted as at 1st April from its book. Okay. So they have told that they have equity shares, 250,000. So they have equity shares. Then they have secured debentures on land and building. So secured debentures on land and building. So in which list will it come? Or what kind of asset or what kind of liability it is? Can someone tell me? So which list will we show this? You can answer me, then I'll come back to it. Okay, then you have unsecured loan, trade creditors, land and building. Okay, so here someone has answered me that it will come under list B because it is secured against one single asset. If a liability is secured under one single asset, it will come under list B. It is nothing but assets specifically pledged. Okay, then you have secured, unsecured loan, trade creditors, land and building. So then you have other PPE, then you have current assets, then you have profit and loss account debit balance, then you have contingent liabilities for bill discount and excise duty demands. You have, then you have contingent liabilities. Okay, fine. So they have told you that on investigation, it was found out that the contingent liabilities are certain to devolve and that assets are likely to be realized as follows. So here in this line, first I'll explain you. They have told that contingent liabilities are certain to devolve. That means whatever we have written as contingent liability. So contingent liability is a liability that may or may not happen depending on the future circumstances. That may or may not come as liabilities depending on the future circumstances. So here they have told you that it is certain to devolve. So they are going to devolve as liabilities only. So that's why we will take it as liabilities. Okay. Then they have told that assets are likely to be realized as follows. So land and building, they have given you other PPE and current assets. So all of these, they have told that these assets are going to be realized under this value. So now what we are going to do is we are going to start by preparing our statement of affairs. So first you have to write statement of affairs of Insol Limited in liquidation as on the date. Okay. So as on the date you are preparing the statement of affairs, the same date you have to write it there. Okay. So you have to start by writing this. Okay. So first I told you, first you will do assets not specifically pledged as per list A. You have to write that. Did I tell you or not? In our format, it was first list A, then we used to write on list B, assets specifically pledged. So first you have to start with writing assets not specifically pledged. First you have to see what and all assets are there in the, what and all assets are actually, there in the book. So if you have land and building, you have other PPE and you have current assets. So there are three assets in the book. From these three assets, against debentures, already land and building you have secured. Already land and building you have secured against debentures. So this will come under assets specifically pledged. So what will come under list A? List A is assets not specifically pledged. That means assets other than assets specifically pledged. So other than plant and machinery, what are the remaining two assets that are left? So it will be other property, plant and equipment and current assets. Okay. Yes. Very good. So these both will come under assets specifically pledged. So here see, you have written other property, plant and equipment and current assets. So here you have given two values. Here they have told you that other property, plant and equipment is 20 lakh rupees. And they have told you that current assets is 45 lakh rupees. But when I told you this, I always told you that you have to take realizable value only. Whatever value is realizable, that value only you have to take while you are writing. So they have given the realizable value is as follows. In case that there are no realizable value given, then you can take the actual value. But if realizable value is given, you have to take that value only. So other property, plant and equipment, it is 18 lakh. Current assets, it is 35 lakh rupees. So see, 18 lakh rupees, 35 lakh rupees. So what is the total of assets not specifically pledged? 53 lakh rupees is the total. So this amount you can use to pay to the liabilities or settle the liabilities. Okay. Next you have to write assets specifically pledged as per list B. So I told you first you have to start by writing what the asset is that and its estimated realizable value and then its due. How much this asset should be used to pay to the secured creditors, then whatever the deficiencies and then whatever the surplus is. Okay. So what was the asset which was specifically pledged? Like we already saw, land and building was specifically pledged to debentures. So land and building we will write here. So land and building we will write here. So what is its estimated realizable value? So here the realizable value of land and building is 11 lakh rupees. The realizable value of land and building is 11 lakh rupees. Then though this land and building, how much you have to use against creditors, you have to see. So here there is written secured debentures on land and building is 10 lakh rupees only. So using this land and building, you have to pay 10 lakh rupees only. So here you will write how much you have to pay to the secured creditors using this land and building. You have to pay 10 lakh to the secured creditors. So here tell me whether it is deficiency or surplus. So here see, the amount that you will receive by selling land and building is 11 lakh rupees. But the amount that you have to actually pay is 10 lakh rupees only. So 1 lakh rupees will be your surplus. So 1 lakh rupees will be your surplus. So this 1 lakh rupees, you can use it to pay other liabilities. Pay other liabilities. So this 1 lakh rupees will come in the outer column as 1 lakh. No, there is no deficiency. Okay. So this total will be 53 lakh rupees plus 1 lakh rupees. The total is 54 lakh rupees. So what is this 54 lakh rupees? It is the estimated total assets available to unsecured creditors. That means to other liabilities, how much money you have to pay them. You totally have 54 lakh rupees now. Okay. So I hope you have understood this. Okay. So here, as I told you, I'll name it I and here I'll name it J. Okay, fine. So I hope these both are clear and you don't have any doubt in this. So I told you after that you have to write something known as summary of gross assets. Summary of gross assets means nothing but list A assets you have to write and list B assets also you have to write. That is assets not specifically pledged and assets specifically pledged you have to write, I told you. Okay. So what was assets not specifically pledged? Assets not specifically pledged was 53 lakh rupees. So 53 lakh rupees you have to write as list A. Then list B, I told you that you have to write the amount which has been actually realized by the asset. That means 11 lakh rupees you have to write. Okay, how much you pay or paid doesn't matter. How much did you realize or will realize by selling the asset, that you have to write. Here you told 53 lakh rupees is what we'll realize by selling the asset not specifically pledged. Then the asset which is specifically pledged by selling that, how much will you receive? 11 lakh rupees. So 11 lakh rupees also you have to write here. So 11 lakh plus 53 lakh, total 64 lakh is the summary of gross assets that you have realized. Okay. Fine. So I hope until this everything is clear. See, I see only one person answering. Very good. The other people, what are you doing? So until this, have you understood? Until this, any doubts? Any doubts until this? Clear? Anybody else? Any doubts? No, right? Okay, fine. So the next what we are going to see is gross liabilities. So I told you. After doing the assets, you have to write down liabilities. Okay, so gross liabilities realized, you will have to write first. Okay, so I will show this as this here has become like a little bit. Okay, I can show you from here itself. Okay, so first, like I told you, first you have to start by writing your balance brought down. So how much is the balance brought down? Can someone tell me? So the balance brought down will be J. So this will be K. Okay. So how much is the balance brought down that you can pay to the liabilities? So it is 54 lakh rupees. So 54 lakh rupees is the amount which is balance brought down. That means which is ready to be payable to. Ready to be payable to who? The all the creditors and liabilities. Okay. So after that, I told you first you will start by writing your list B, then list C. Then where is list D? Okay, I think they don't have any list D, so they have just skipped it. Then you'll have list D, then you'll have list E, then F, G, H and all, I'll tell you afterwards. So here, so until this, you have to first see. Okay, until this. Okay. So first you have to write list B. So list B, I told you that for the balance brought down, here you will write as 0 and here you will write as 54 lakh rupees. List B, I told you, you will write all the secured creditors. You will write all the secured creditors, okay? So secured creditors, what was your secured creditor? Secured creditors was your debentures. So debentures you have to write here. So what is the outstanding amount of... One second. See, here actually I have written it clearly, if you can see. Okay. So, see, I'll explain you from this. Then from that, I'll make you tick mark it. So, balance brought down, I told you, will be 54 lakh rupees. Then you have to reduce secured creditors of fixed charge. That is list B, which is going to be debentures in such case. Which is debentures. So, debentures, here you have to do dash only. Okay. Because... before this 54 lakh itself, you have already paid it. This 54 lakh rupees is only after paying the fixed charge, correct? because only surplus of list B is added here. So this 54 lakh rupees is after all, is after paying your fixed charge assets, right? So what you have to do is, or secured assets, you can say fixed charge or secured assets, so that you will not take into consideration. So you'll not reduce it from this. So nothing you'll write here. So here, how, what was the gross value? How much it was paid? It was paid for 10 lakh rupees. So 10 lakh rupees alone you will write here. Then from this also, you have to reduce again unsecured creditors. So you don't see unsecured creditors. Ignore the wording here. So see, okay. So here next you will pay something known as preferential creditors. Let's just see. So how much was the preferential creditors? What and all come under preferential creditors? You have to see. So I told you like six items I told you, right? So from these and all, here there is only one item which is related to preferential creditors, which is excise duty demands. Because excise duty is related to whom? It is collected by government, right? So excise duty is collected by government. So always remember, excise duty demands are usually collected by government. So all the payments that are due to government will come under preferential creditors. Preferential creditors, correct? So how much is that? So it is 1,50,000 rupees. So this alone you will pay under preferential creditors. 1,50,000 rupees you will pay. So here also 1,50,000 you have to write. So the amount that you have remaining is 52,50,000. The amount that you have remaining is 52,50,000. Then next thing what you have to write is, the next thing that you have to, one second. Okay. So the next thing that you have to reduce is floating charge, list D. Floating charge, list D. So floating charge, you did not have anything in the question. Usually you will have debentures, but in this question, debentures was given as a secured creditors fixed charge itself. So it was given as secured creditors itself. So here you did not have debentures also. So list D is nil. So list D is nil, here also nil. So the remaining pay amount that you have to pay other liabilities is 52,50,000. After that, you will have to go to list E. So what was list E once again? So what was list E? List E was unsecured creditors, list E. So all the other liabilities other than the above liabilities will come under this. So first we'll see what and all is remaining. So see, already you have done secured debentures, you have already paid. Next, you have in secured debentures, one portion was not paid, right? No, I think the whole was paid. Yes, sorry, we only had surplus, everything was paid, correct? So the whole amount of, one second. So the whole amount of 10 lakh was already paid. Then next, you have unsecured loans. So unsecured loan, you have not paid it, so it will go under unsecured creditors. Trade creditors will also not paid, so it will go under unsecured creditors. Then what other do you have? Then you have bills discounted. So bills discount is also a liability that you have to pay, so it will go under unsecured creditors. Okay. Then I think that's it. So all these three will go under unsecured creditors. So you will have, see, unsecured loan of 20 lakh, trade creditors of 35 lakh and bill discounted of 1 lakh. So all these three will come under unsecured creditors of list E, which total is 56 lakh rupees. So if you do 52,50,000 minus 56 lakh rupees, the amount that you have as deficiency to creditors is 3,50,000. Okay, that means after paying out all the liabilities from the assets that we had, we are left out with a deficiency of 3,50,000. Okay. So here what you have to do is, here also you have to total the gross value column. So it was 10 lakh, 1,50,000 plus 52,50,000. Okay, here what you have to write is the amount which you can actually pay. The amount which you have actually pay or paid. The amount which you can actually pay or paid. Secured creditors, you paid 10 lakh. Preferential creditors, you paid 1,50,000. Floating charge, you did not have. Unsecured creditors, you were only able to pay 52,50,000 out of 56 lakh because the remaining 3,50,000 was deficiency. So 52,50,000 you will write here and the total will be. So can you please remove whatever you have did on the screen? So whoever did it, okay. So the amount that you that will come under gross liabilities is 64 lakh rupees. No, sorry, just give me a second. I made a mistake here. Okay, you see, okay. So you actually need not, what do I say? Need not rate as 64 lakh rupees. You can directly take it as 56 lakh itself. So in the new book, it has been given like this only. So can someone tell me the total? So can someone tell me the total of this? All right, let's say total weight. So what was the total of gross value column? 10 lakh plus 1 lakh 50,000 plus 56 lakh. So it is 67 lakh 50,000. So that is the gross value that you have to write here. Okay. So now you will see what is the gross asset value realized. So gross asset value realized, where did we find out? We found out after list A and list B. See, gross assets realized, it was 64 lakh rupees. So the same thing you'll write here, 64 lakh rupees. What is gross liability paid? It is also 64 lakh rupees. Sorry, gross liability paid is actually 67 lakh 50,000. Here you have to make changes, and according to that, the answer will come. Okay. Then finally, you will have distribution to members. Then finally, you have distribution to members. It will be deficiency to creditors was 350,000. You don't have preference shareholders of list F, so you'll not write anything here. Finally, you have equity shareholders as per list G. Okay, so that will come as 25 lakh. You'll pay them 25 lakh rupees. See in the question, you have 25 lakh rupees. Okay, 25 lakh rupees you have. That also you'll pay. So you will be left with a deficiency of 28 lakh 50,000. So you'll be left with a deficiency as to members of list H of 28 lakh 50,000. So I hope until this everything is clear. Okay. Is it clear? Any doubts, guys? Any list or any part that you want me to explain again? Any list or any part that you want me to explain again? Or is everything clear? So first we started with list A, then list B, then we wrote the summary, then we wrote gross assets, gross liabilities realized, then we wrote distribution to members. I want each and every single person watching this to tell me if it is clear or not. If not, also I can explain it once again. Because if you understand this only, the other all sums you will be able to understand. This is a very basic sum. Okay, guys, I'll wait until you answer. Clear? Please clear. Other people, I think I have got only one, two, three, four, five replies. How much? Okay, just give me a second. If nothing is said about a particular liability, it will become as unsecured creditors. Yes, correct. If nothing is said about a particular liability, it will become as unsecured creditor. Correct. Okay. So I don't know about the others. I think everybody who is there have answered. If you didn't answer, I don't know. I think Deepika, did you answer if you understood or not? So you cannot ask each and everybody, right? Have you answered already? No. Did you understand or not? Understood. Then you must have answered, right? Okay, fine. No problem. So see, today I'll stop it with here. I think this is already a lot of concept to your brains. So the list H deficiency account, in the next class when we are doing all the sums, I'll explain you then. Okay. So today what and all we have seen, I'll just tell you in the about the next class also, I'll tell you. Just hold on. So today we understood about the statement of affairs. We saw what are the eight lists, how you have to prepare a statement of affairs account, okay, and what and all or how and all figures you will put inside it. We did not see list H until this. We'll see it afterwards. Then we solved illustration 11 from the new book, okay.
So yes guys, we have come towards the end of the video. So the remaining sums, that is the remaining practical problems and illustrations, will come up in another video, which will be the next video on statement of affairs. So I hope you found this video helpful. If you did, please do like, share and subscribe to the channel. And also don't forget to hit on the notification icon so you get notified every time I post a new video.